is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Unspoiled, covering Doctor Who, Season 3, Episode 1. Wait, no. Episode 11. That's weird. This says Season 301 on it. That's what got me all confused. Fucking Amazon. Just be cool, guys. Episode 11, Blink. In this episode, we finally get to meet the weeping angels that I have seen cosplayed so many times. They are very creepy. They have creepy faces. I really liked this episode. It was super weird and just spooky, and I liked it. Welcome to Unspoiled.
There is a resounding cheer happening around the world.
Yeah, this, like, when I saw the title for it, I was like, I feel like this is famous. Is this famous, this episode?
This is probably what people would say is the best episode of Doctor Who, if not in the top two.
Okay. Yeah, when I was watching it, Owen said that that was the first episode of Doctor Who that he ever saw. Which I feel like you don't want to do that. I feel like that's a bad thing to do, is to watch the, like, alleged best one before anything else. But, you know.
It is the kind of episode that you can show to people who have never seen Doctor Who as a complete standalone, especially because the Doctor and Martha are barely in it. Mm-hmm. And it can stand on its own as a really good story.
Yeah, I think that it's surprising to me how much I like, gave a shit, considering that the Doctor and Martha are not in it, and we're getting some brand new, you know, it's similar to, in that way, to the one that we hated that was so silly.
Oh, Love and Monsters?
That's the one.
Yeah.
But I actually liked these people and wanted to know what happened, you know?
Well, they hit the jackpot in casting Carrie Mulligan. Because she's just incredible, and you want to watch her.
Yeah.
She's so beautiful.
Yeah, she
in
is.
This episode, so beautiful. And she just, you care about her immediately.
Yeah.
And that just makes a huge difference. If somebody else had been cast as Sally Sparrow, I don't know if it would have worked as well.
Interesting.
Even though the story is really, really good.
Yeah.
And it's written by Stephen Moffat, who is very hit or miss.
Indeed.
But his standalone Doctor Who episodes were always among my favorites, which is what upset me when there were other things in his, like, storytelling that I didn't like. Because I love The Girl in the Fireplace, as stated previously, and I love the shit out of this episode. And these are Moffat episodes.
I love the shit out of this episode.
I really do. It's so good. And it's one of the episodes that I have watched over and over again just by itself.
Yeah, I feel like there's just a really, like, I really like the concept of these creatures so much. And they honestly don't feel Whovian to me almost at all. I don't know if it's because they look like something so familiar, whereas everything else has been an alien with a really specific design, and this is something that feels sort of ordinary, and that's what makes it more fun, or if it's just the whole concept of how they work that I find really interesting. I think that might be it.
It might be a bit of both.
Yeah.
Because you'll never look at a statue the same way.
Right. Yeah, I the only thing that I didn't really get was the explanation for why they throw people into the past.
Well, it uses up their energy. Like, it takes the... They do explain it, sort of. He calls it, like, killing people with, in a like with kindness or something, like throws them back into another time and they just live out their lives. But I think that somehow the Weeping Angels gain some kind of energy from that.
Yeah, he says something like they take the potential energy from the life that you were going to live.
Yeah.
And I don't understand why that energy isn't taken with you, because you still create an entire life that wasn't going to exist in the past.
Right.
So I don't really understand how that is supposed to work, but it's fine.
It's just such a, like, what a crazy idea that they see you, you see them, like they're not hiding their faces, and then you get zoomed back to some point in the past and then just have to live. And the two examples that we see in this, they lived fairly well. But maybe that doesn't always happen. Maybe you get zoomed back to Neanderthal times and like fucking big elephant kills you. What are they called? Mammoths.
Indeed.
Oh god. I was gonna say dinosaur, but I'm like, wait, dinosaurs are already dead by the time they were Neanderthals. I was trying to be actually scientific.
Dinosaurs. A dino elephant, you know, the one.
You know, the big hairy elephant. Or maybe you get zoomed back to some point in the middle of a war zone and die.
Have you seen like these... Dark?
No, not yet. Jason just watched the first season.
Okay. Because somebody has been commissioning episodes for Spoil Me. It is super good. And there is something kind of like this. And I won't get into spoilers, obviously. But... you know, inadvertently being thrown into another time. And I honestly can't think of anything more horrifying. Like, you are somewhere where everything is going to be utterly unfamiliar. You might not even be far enough back in time that you don't know anybody. You may know people who are still alive, and yet you don't. So there's almost even more of a tease, because your parents could be around, but you're not around yet or something, you know? And you don't have money that anybody's going to accept. You can't even, like, do that. The technology is going to be completely different and simple shit. I mean, going back to 1920, flushing a toilet is going to be a bit confusing, you know?
Yeah.
Just, like, every little thing is going to be different. And we laugh about, like, oh, can you imagine living back when we didn't have GPS? Yes, I can. I did it. Mm-hmm. I hated it at the time, and knowing what I'm missing and going back to that is so much worse.
Yeah.
And I just, that in particular, losing out on technology that I remember and was using would just hurt. It would hurt so bad.
And both of the people we see get taken back, Kathy and Billy. Kathy goes all the way back to 1920. She's wearing jeans. You know, knee-high boots and a leather jacket, I think. And, like, she must have looked so crazy to this guy. How did she adjust? Like, I would love to have a little side story, even if it's, like, a little novella. Like, how Kathy ended up adapting to 1920 and living this life that she, in her letter, says she had a good life. But how did you do that when you... 2 seconds ago had cell phones.
Yeah, that's really my question as well, was like, what, because the guy that she meets, well, you know what, let's start talking about the episode, shall we? Let's just do that.
Yes.
So we have Sally, who is breaking into a old abandoned manor house, and she's doing this just for the opportunity to take cool photos. Because I thought that she was doing something like, you know, investigative journalism, and I'm going to go to the source of the thing. But it's nothing so intense as that. It's just that she's like, this place is gorgeous, and I want to document the melancholy of this abandoned place. And as she is looking around, she notices some wallpaper that is partially peeled off. And she goes up to it and takes the rest of it off and gradually uncovers a message that says, "Beware the Weeping Angel, duck." And then, "Sally Sparrow, duck now." And a moment later, she finally realizes, like, this is really directed at her. She ducks, a piece of stone lands. And then when she finishes peeling it off, it says, "Love, the Doctor." Now, who is it? The Weeping Angel that chucked a rock at her?
I think so.
How is that not something that happens again?
I don't know. I don't know if it's for sure, because it's not revealed that this rock, where this rock came from.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it was, because she looks out the window and there's a Weeping Angel with its hands covering its
mm-hmm,
eyes.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that the angel did it.
That's weird.
Maybe to get her to come out, although they can come in, so I don't know why that would matter.
Yeah. Hmm.
And the Doctor's message, "Love from the Doctor," 1969.
Right.
So she knows that it came from 1969, which is weird.
Yeah. And she says something later about, like, how could this be here? And I do wonder, like, how unusual a name her name is, because one could say, well, you know, there was another Sally Sparrow. But it's just like, when you add up the fact that she did duck and something did land and was going to have hit her in the head. But yeah, so she comes away from there and it's still night and she gets home and there are like a million TVs going in the apartment. And it takes a minute before I realize that this isn't actually her place. She's at her friend's.
Mm-hmm.
But they are all playing a video of the Doctor, who is saying, "Don't turn your back, don't look away, and don't blink." They are unbelievably fast. And she takes no notice of this and is calling her friend. It's apparently 1 a.m. And she's like, "Yeah, no, come with me. I'm about to make you some coffee. I'm in your house." Which, what? No. No, I don't think so. Friend, you go home, get your gym jams on, you come back at a human hour to make me coffee, you banana. But yeah, and her friend's roommate is just coming out of the shower. What is
his
name?
No, it's her friend's, his name is Larry, he's her brother.
Right.
His name is actually Lawrence, their last name is Nightingale. Oh, Stephen Moffat. And you're Lawrence
Why?
Nightingale nonsense. But for the rest of the episode, he goes by Larry.
I hate it.
I know. It's bad.
Ugh.
Sally Sparrow, I can accept. Maybe Kathy Nightingale, I can accept. Because Sparrow and Nightingale, it's like we're watching some kind of fairy tale.
Yeah, right.
But Lawrence Nightingale is a step too far.
Yeah, that's a lot. Wish you hadn't told me that, Jamie.
I can't believe you didn't notice.
Yeah, because I do remember her saying that it's her brother, but I completely forgot about that. So it wasn't until you reminded me that I even remembered that he'd have the same last name. But yeah, he comes out and he is standing in the towel. And it's really funny how, like, embarrassed they both are, because he's just in a towel.
He's
it's fine. It's
not
a big deal.
I think he's supposed to not be even in a towel.
Is he not?
Yeah. Because he's like, "Am I?"
Oh,
and she goes,
dear.
"No." And then
oh,
Kathy
right.
Yells
he says
about
pants.
Not wearing pants.
That's right. And she says no to pants. That's right. Yeah. Because it's positioned in such a way that there is, like, the counter, and it looks like he's got a towel on because of this, like, piece of, I guess it's a kitchen lamp that's hanging. So I saw that as the towel being wrapped around him. But, yeah, no. Well, howdy doody. Hey, nanny, nanny. So...
I can't believe you said howdy doody.
Howdy doody is a really awkward, weird greeting, and that feels appropriate for real awkward, weird meetup of somebody being pantsless. Am I wrong?
Yep. No, it's just weird and funny.
So she has her friend come with her in the morning, which begs the question why you decided to wake her up at 1 a.m. when you waited until daylight anyway. But okay, sure. And they go inside to this place because she wants to show her where her name was written and, like, you know, show her this cool place that she found. And they're looking through, and the houses are really, like, the whole set is really cool. You know, they have all of these really old-fashioned wallpapers that are peeling off. They have these, like, original style floorboards and whatnot that have all these dead leaves over them and vines growing in through a bunch of places because there was, like, this huge garden that's been neglected and left. And chandeliers that are sitting, like, half wrapped up, like somebody was in the middle of packing them for the winter and then was like, fuck this, and just left. And it just is a really great location for, like, a Halloween party. That's what I would do. And they're looking through the house and she's, you know, meaning to show her name on the wall, but her friend gets distracted by the weeping angel in the yard. And she looks over at it and is like, that's weird. It's moved closer to the house. Like, it wasn't this near yesterday when I was here. But when I saw it, like, when the first time when she looks outside, I was just like, oh, shit, that's what this is. Okay, cool. Because I knew that these were a thing. Mm-hmm. And I recognized the name of this episode as having been talked about. But I didn't know anything about the episode. I didn't know when these things showed up. So I didn't have any sort of connective tissue for any of these things. It was just all sort of starting to come together. So, yeah, she shows her friend that it says her name and whatnot on it. And as they're about to talk over how this could be possible, there is a ringing at the door. And we find out, as everything happens, that this actually ends up being Kathy's grandson.
Yeah.
Whom she made promise to bring the letter from her at this exact time. And this dude, who plays her grandson, apparently the actor's name is Malcolm Wainwright. He played a really creepy undertaker on the very, very first episode of Midsummer Murders. And I do not care how much he got his teeth fixed, how much he's grown, how much he shaved and cut his hair, and how much more dignified he looks now. He will never not be that creepy fucking undertaker. And I know that you all know who I'm talking about if you've watched that show, because it's like he's just so memorable in that role because he is unnerving. And it's not like creepy like, ooh, I like to play with dead bodies. It's creepy in like, I have like a vaguely pervy vibe and also love drama to a point where I would obviously like mess with shit to get to see a performance because I just live off of it. And he is, later on, the woman who plays him and his mother in Midsummer Murders are recast, like, seasons and seasons later as other characters, and it is mentioned that they are these characters' cousins. But it's just the exact same actors, and they just decided to, like, fucking lean into it, and I just find that so delightful. So anyway, a little bit of Midsummer trivia for you all. If you don't watch Midsummer Murders, I don't understand why not, because it is peak trashy mystery TV. There's literally episodes where there's like bodies that have been preserved and kept in secret bedrooms for like 25 years because somebody can't let go of their like dead lover. It's great. It's so stupid. So
did that show come out in like the 90s?
Yes, it did, and it is still running. It's on season 17, I think, now.
Orlando Bloom was in an
episode.
Yeah,
he was.
Yeah, that's the extent of what I know about Midsummer Murders is that Orlando Bloom, I think that was like the first thing he ever was cast mm-hmm. in.
Yeah, and he plays like a combination like ne'er-do-well slash rent boy for the older ladies of the town who just want to get some action and they're married and bored.
I mean, why wouldn't yeah. you? He's so cute.
And he, yeah, the whole, like, Midsummer Murders, guys, it is some good shit. It's one of those shows that, like, I finished, I had on Prime, like, the very newest season. And once I finished it, I turned around and I turned episode one of season one back on again. And I just left that on while I got some work done because it's just that kind of thing.
That's, like, people who watch Law and Order.
You know, I've been thinking about getting into Law and Order because I need another show like this. And I've just been kind of like worried that I'm going to find like that it's going to be really tasteless about certain issues. I don't know how it's aged and I don't know how much that would bother me. So I've been kind of like thinking about it, but also afraid that I'm just going to be like irritated.
It's a not a point of pride, but it's something that I've never seen a single episode of Law
Me
and
Order. Me neither.
Of any Law and Orders. And when people find out, they're like, how is that possible? You love television and those shows have been on for like 20 years. And I'm like, because I never watched it. I don't know. Like, now it's just, it's too much.
Yeah, I've never, there's an episode of Community that is a spoof of Law and Order, and I've seen that. That's the closest I've ever gotten.
I've seen that as well, and it's a really good one.
But yeah, there's a Andrew from Overdue has another podcast called Appointment Television, where he and a couple of friends talk about, they don't talk about like particular television episodes necessarily. They'll talk about different issues within television. And one of the episodes I listened to recently was TV that everybody seems to watch and nobody ever talks about. And Law and Order was one of them. Just shows that just run forever, that apparently get decent ratings and get renewed for 20 years, but nobody ever talks about watching them and how weird it is, you know?
Yeah, they don't cost a lot to produce. Mm-hmm.
That makes sense.
Something like Law and Order. I've thought about watching it as well. I don't know where it's streaming. I think SVU is streaming, but Original Flavor is not.
Oh, and that's annoying.
I'm not really interested in SVU.
Yeah, me neither.
Because that's all sex crimes and shit. And I just, you know what? I don't need that.
Yeah, same.
But Original Flavor Law & Order is like other crimes as well. And I think that that would be a little more interesting. And I do love a procedural.
Well, guys, if anybody knows where we can find it, let us know. And let us know how it's aged and if there would be some stuff that's super offensive that we're just like, no.
There is a podcast that I listen to, and one of the hosts, two of the hosts, but one of them in particular, she just loves Law and Order, has been watching it forever. And she is also very hypercritical about a lot of things and has never actually said, like, when she's gone back, and she basically watches it every day on reruns. Mm. And the impression I get from the way she talks about it is that it does hold up.
That's like, and Rashawn really likes it. Like, and I feel like that speaks well for it.
Yeah, I think it, I don't think that it is that kind of show that would, I mean, I'm sure there's some things. The show's been around since the 90s, so there's going to be probably some like transphobia kind of stuff or like gay panic now and then. But I think overall, it probably tried to handle a lot of these crimes as delicately as possible. And it's really more about catching the criminal and then trying the criminal more than like, you know, having bombastic kind of episodes. And that's why I'm more interested in Law and Order than SVU. Right. 'Cause I feel like SVU gets more into like just shit.
you know what I mean? Indeed.
Just shit.
I also just really like, dun, 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 dun. It's just a good, it's a good theme song.
We all
song,
know the theme,
you know?
Song. We've never seen the show, but we know the theme song. We also know the dun dun
dun dun. Yeah, it's very chill. There's something about it that just makes me be like, this is good. Like, I'm about to sit down and eat my like microwave dinner and just want something to like unwind to after a day in my cubicle.
I'm a big fan of why is his name escaping me now? He was on The Newsroom, and he's on Grace and Frankie now, and he's got that super amazing voice.
I do not know.
Fuck, I'm going to look it up right now. I love him, and when I said something about how much I love his voice, because I think the first thing I ever saw him in was The Newsroom, my friend Darnell was like, how come you don't know this? He was on Law & Order for forever, and I was like, I have never seen Law & Order. Mm-hmm. And he was super mad at me. Like, how is it even possible that you have not seen Law & Order? And I was like, I don't know how to answer that question. I just haven't seen it. What is his name?
We have
then we'll
get back to talking about this thing.
Yeah. So Sam Waterston.
Sam Waterston. Okay. Got you. Anyway, yes, sorry for that tangent, guys. So this dude tells her, I'm looking for Sally Sparrow. I was told to bring this letter on this exact date at this exact time to Sally Sparrow. And as he's delivering this to her with his creepy Undertaker hands.
I didn't find him creepy, just FYI, because I have not seen that.
That's exactly, like, that's all. He isn't creepy at all. But he was so unforgettable in that one role that I will never get over it for as long as I live.
I get it. I just wanted to put out there, like, he's not actually creepy. You just think he's
definitely
creepy.
Yes. It's totally my bias. And the woman who played his mother in that, I'm sure, is a delightful woman. She strikes me as somebody that's, like, really fun and hilarious, probably. But she comes across as, like, this unholy hag. And I have not seen her in anything else. And I know if I did, I would just be like, somebody has to murder her immediately. We need to get this woman out of the way. So anyway, she's in the middle of talking to this guy, and we see Kathy in these rooms, like, messing around, noticing that this angel statue has, again, come a little bit closer. And she seems to not totally discount that the way that some people might. She looks a little bit freaked when she notices that it seems to have moved again. And she starts to leave the room. And when she does, the camera turns around, and we see that the hands of the statue have pulled away from its face. Mm-hmm. And it's super creepy, and I hate it.
Mm-hmm.
And then she's, like, opening another door, and the camera's looking at her over her shoulder, and we see the statue right near the window behind her. And it's just so effective, like, building up that this thing is coming at her, but not letting us see it move either as viewers, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah.
And I have to say, Kathy is also super pretty, and I'm really sad that she's not going to get to rock that frosted lip gloss ever again, because she really made it work, and that is not easy to do.
She has a Welsh accent. You can tell they cast her out of Cardiff.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. I think she was trying not to be too Welsh, but she couldn't hide it.
Trying not to be too Welsh. she's in the middle of listening to this conversation and just unaware that this thing is slowly tracking her through the house. And she, you know, has her back, like, half in a room.
Mm-hmm.
And the door is, she's, like, standing half out the door listening. And then you hear this, like, weird sort of pop. What is that supposed to be? Is it the door slamming shut?
A door does slam shut. It might be that one of the angels moved closer or popped into the room.
Ooh, can they just pop in like that?
They seem to be able to move really quickly.
That's so weird. I want to know more about the rules for these guys. This distracts Sally, obviously, who tells this dude that this is sick. And I feel real bad for him, because he obviously is just doing what his Grammy asked him to do. And he was not ready for this.
And you didn't mention that he gives her this letter. And in the letter it's a letter from Kathy apologizing for, you know,
disappearing.
And then there's pictures.
Yeah.
And Sally is just so upset about this. Like, why would you do this? This is sick. Mm-hmm. Like, why are you trying to play some crazy trick on me? How did you get her photos? You know, like, Photoshop probably existed at the time. So maybe she was thinking that that's what this was.
Yeah. I mean, she at first tries to be like, well, so they must have been related because they're practically identical. Mm-hmm. And then when she's reading the thing and it's like, you know, I was gone and I will never see you again, but don't feel bad. And it's just like, it sounds like insanity as she's reading it. And she's just like, why are you fucking with me? What did I do to you? Meanwhile, poor Catherine is in a field in Hull.
Yeah, I don't know where Hull is.
Now, when he says, this is Hull, and she says, no, it isn't. You're in Hull. I'm not in Hull. Stop saying Hull. I would like to point out that on the subtitles, Hull is not capitalized. And I'm wondering if that's something else. Like, so Hull, or Kingston upon Hull, is a port city in East Yorkshire, England. So her other friend later, he just gets transported back in time, but he doesn't move places, right? Or does he get
moved places? No, he just, he got, well, I think he moves within London.
So that she's getting moved in time and space.
She's getting, in, at least in time and place.
Isn't place and space
the space, same? I guess they're the same. I think of space as space.
Indeed. Okay, yeah. I just wanted to establish that because I wasn't sure about that either. Aren't,
I don't know. Like you said, the rules aren't exactly clear. I think they just move them. And for whatever reason, Billy ends up staying in London. But he's not, like, in the exact place where he had been.
He's not?
No. Because he was in that warehouse and he, like, ends up in an alley.
Yeah, that's right. He's outside and it's raining and stuff, I think. Or it had been raining. All right, yeah. So she goes up to this dude and he's, like, trying to show her the paper because she keeps arguing with him about where she is. And she sees that it's, what, 1920? 1902? Yeah.
1920.
1902 is when she said she was born because she lied and said that she was 18.
You lying cow.
I love that. But yeah, meanwhile, back in our time, poor Sally is wandering around like, Kathy? Kathy, where are you? And, getting more and more confused and more suspicious of this poor innocent grandson who's just trying to do his job. And I just feel real bad for Kathy. This sucks. Sally, you shouldn't have invited her here. It's all your fault.
She made the best of it.
Yep. Yeah, all the photos and everything is pretty wild. Like, I could see her planning, basically. Because having a lot of photos of yourself when it was expensive to do, it was just not a common thing for people who didn't have money. Mm-hmm. And I could just really see that being a huge priority for her because she's like, someday I am going to need somebody to make sure that she knows what happened and she won't believe it if she doesn't see me. So I'm going to make sure to get photos taken every time I have a little spare change to pay somebody to do it, you know, like basically documenting every step of the way. Because we see her with her kids gathered around her. Just like there's a bunch of moments that she's got in there, getting older with the same kids and she's all gray haired and everything. And it's adorable. That's the only reason that I would ever want to have kids is to eventually have grandkids and then be that like gray-haired granny who lets them eat way too many cookies and then sends them home with their parents. Or just has like an awesome spot where I can just put them to run themselves ragged until they inevitably fall asleep of their own accord after eating too many cookies. Anyway, cookies are a very central part of why I would want to have children, is what I'm saying. These angels, when she goes upstairs to try and find Kathy, are in the fucking room.
Yep.
And it's like, she can tell they have something to do with things, but she can't figure out what that could be. And she sees the key that's hanging from one of their hands. And I love this because as she's kneeling down to get the key, the angel from behind her drops its hands away from its face.
Mm-hmm.
And then when she is kneeling, we see it over her shoulder looking at her. But when she stands and faces it again, it's already moved its hands back into place.
Yep.
So that's really fun. I just really like that the audience is treated like our seeing them affects them also. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because her back is to that one. It could have got her.
Right, and we haven't gotten an explanation yet at this point. Mm-hmm. So the audience is still trying to figure out, like, what is going on?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, and I don't know How do we ever get an explanation of how it got the key to the TARDIS?
No.
Okay. Well, whatever that winds up being.
No, we don't get an explanation of how they got the key, but we do know that something that they did zoomed the Doctor and Martha back to 1969 while the TARDIS was still... The TARDIS had come to this place, which is called Wester Drumlins, this old house.
Right, right.
And they... The Weeping Angels kick them back to 1969. The TARDIS was still there.
Mm-hmm.
When she meets Billy, he shows her all of these cars that have been abandoned at Wester Drumlins and this old police box that they can't figure out how to get into.
Mm, right.
So that's how the TARDIS gets to the police station.
But there's no...
They're trying to... The Angels are trying to get the TARDIS.
Because they're going
to
eat it, basically.
Yeah, because they want its energy.
Mm-hmm. All right, so it has the key somehow, and she grabs that key up, and that is part of why they start to come after her the way that they do, because they want that shit back, bitch. We worked to get it. And I just, like, I don't know. Ooh. I just saw the part where she, like, kind of gives a screech as she looks up and the statues have come even closer. And I have the sound off and everything, but it still startled me because the camera angle and everything, it was just like, oh God, it's right there. But she goes running outside and the dude who delivered the message is gone. And I really do wish that she had asked for contact information or something so that she could, like, track him down again. Because I would just want to know everything about what went down with my friend. You know, I would be fucking giving him the third degree. And as she leaves, there's all of these angels staring out the window at her as she goes.
Yeah.
It's real creepy. I like it. So she goes to a coffee shop and, is reading the rest of the letter from her friend and just kind of disbelieving. But at this point, her friend is, like, missing. So what else are you going to think, you know? And she goes to the cemetery that she is directed to. And her fucking tombstone is there. Gravestone.
Yep.
And the whole thing is just really, like, so sudden and sad. Like, can you imagine how weird that would be? You're just hanging out with your friend. And then all of a sudden they're gone. And then you get a letter that not only did they travel through time, but by the time you read it, they will have lived the entirety of an adult life without you.
And it's been an hour.
Yeah. Like, how weird.
Yeah.
I just can't imagine if, like, there's no way to process that, you know, like, but yeah, so that's how she kind of comes to the conclusion that this is the truth, even though it doesn't really make any sense. And as she's leaving, we see another one of those angels in the graveyard.
Mm-hmm.
And part of the letter was, tell my brother that I'd love him. And so she has to go to where her brother works, which is this DVD shop. And there's, like, the equivalent of the Simpsons comic book guy sitting out front. And he lets her go in back. And the tape of the Doctor is still playing. And she's still not putting together that these things might be related. Because, honestly, why would you?
Right.
And she tries to tell him, like, give him the message. And he's like, is she ill? And then, wait, am I ill? Which I really like that being the next thing. Am I sick and don't know about it? How would she know first, dude? But it's fine.
He's not a super bright bulb.
He ain't, no. What is his name again? Oh, that's right. Larry. Oh, God. Ugh. No. He won't accept this.
So he talks about how the Doctor on this video is an Easter egg on some DVDs, but only 17 specific DVDs, and nobody knows how the Easter egg got there.
Yeah, that's pretty fun. I like this method of communication. What a weird thing to do.
Yeah.
I wish that they had talked to her friend and gotten her to enclose a message from them in the note that her grandson sent.
But she went back to 1920 and they went back to 1969.
I mean, she'd come across him eventually, right?
I guess she could, but why would she know to look for them in London?
I would think that the doctor would know to look for her because he had gotten the information that they were going to meet. Like, you know what I mean? Gotten the information that my friend went back to 19, and like, that, I'm just saying that that was an alternate thing. I'm not mad about it, but I don't know what she included in information that she had in that envelope that she wound up giving him when she sees him in the street. I would think that information about her friend's name and the fact that she disappeared would have been included.
I think it was. I think everything she had concerning this situation was in that packet.
Mm-hmm.
But I think because he and Martha went to 1969 and did everything that they had to do so that in the future, Sally does what she takes all the steps she needs to take so that they all can like get back what they need. Going to, you know, arbitrarily visit Kathy just to get a scoop. Because remember, I mean, this is jumping ahead, but at the end when Sally does see the doctor, for her, it's been a year, but for him, it hasn't happened yet.
Right.
So,
but that,
I don't know what his reasoning would be to then take the TARDIS back to 1920 and track down this girl.
But if he has the information after it's already happened, she would be like, yeah, I got this letter from my friend. She disappeared, and then she had sent her grandson to deliver a thing. And he'd be like, oh, great. She delivered you a message already. I'll just tag along and put my message in with hers. You know what I mean?
I guess. But that changes the little mystery that we have about him and the DVD and Billy.
It does. I'm just saying that, you know, maybe it didn't have to be there. And that's fine. I'm not mad about it. I'm just saying, like, practically speaking.
If that had happened, we wouldn't have Billy.
Yeah, he's that's true. Great. Billy's kind of adorable.
Yeah.
It's really one of those, like, unfortunate situations where she comes to report her friend being missing, and the fucking detective hits on her. Yeah. And part of me just wants to be like, come on, guy. But then another part of me is like, yeah, but he's fine as hell, though.
Yeah.
So I can't even, like, really genuinely, like, be mad about it, because I'm like...
And she's also that? Into it.
Yeah, yeah.
She had her little Freudian slip of Sally Shipton.
Oh, my God.
I mean, Sparrow.
Who does that? I love that she keeps just yelling, don't look at me, because that is precisely the correct reaction after doing something like that.
So she gives him her phone number, and even as she's walking out the door, she's like, you better call that.
But yeah, so while she's like talking with him about the Easter egg thing and she leaves and then his friend is like yelling at the TV as she leaves, I don't understand why people don't just go to the police. And this inspires her and she goes to the police. And they at first don't really take her seriously until she mentions specifically where this all happened. And this all rings a bell because there have been a bunch of disappearances connected with that property specifically. And yeah, Billy is adorable, and he's got this accent. I don't know where it's supposed to be from. It sounds like vaguely Caribbean, Jamaican.
Yeah, I think it's Jamaican.
Which I really like, because like when I lived in London, the Caribbean population in the neighborhood that I lived in was huge. And I feel like that is not represented very often in stuff that I see on... you know, about the city of London and people living there. And they were just like a massive presence for me. Like I think about when I hear people with a Caribbean accent, I think about London, you know, I don't really think about the actual port of origin that they originated from. I think about like, oh yeah, when I lived in Brixton, there was like this shop near me that sold whatever, you know? So I was kind of delighted to see that being represented here. And he is just yummy. He's just so yummy. Oh, my God. And I'm bummed because the way this goes, I take it to mean that we're not going to see him again. And I would really like to see him again. I'm just saying, I would have liked for him maybe to have, if all else fails, hooked up with Martha and gotten Martha out from underneath being in love with the Doctor.
Right.
But sadly, that looks like that shit's not going to happen.
Nope. He comes across a weeping angel and blinks.
Yeah. Yeah, that blink. So, he gone. Mm-hmm. The Doctor, like, swoops in as soon as he... Like, that moment where he goes down into that storage area and they're all there, gathered around, is so creepy. Like, I just love how unnerving this all is.
Yeah.
And this... Because this is exactly the type of scary that I like when there is a lot of tension.
Mm-hmm.
It's hard for me as Same. Somebody who has bad anxiety to really cope with it well. I will admit to that.
Same.
Did you see Us?
I haven't seen it yet.
Owen and I went to see that, and I am not kidding. I thought I might throw up. It was like so tense in the first hour that I left like marks on Owen because I was gripping his arm and his leg and his hand. Like, he kept having to move what I was gripping because he was getting like pins and needles because I was just not letting go.
Yeah, I've definitely had some like full on anxiety attacks watching certain movies mm-hmm. because I'm more scared of things I can't see.
Oh, for sure.
And like psychological things mm-hmm. than anything like monstery or gory. Like, that stuff doesn't scare me.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, the Blair Witch Project scared the fucking hell out of me.
Yep, me too.
The first time I saw it. Like, I, like, broke out in tears mm-hmm. because I was so scared that my body couldn't handle it anymore. And I just started crying. Like, that's the most scared I've ever been watching a movie.
And who say, like, well, that wasn't scary. But then they find things scary that I'm just like, why is that?
Right.
What do you mean? Like...
The only monstery thing that scares me is a clown.
Mm, that's fair.
But some aliens too. It depends on the alien in a movie.
Okay, yeah.
Not like alien, like in the movie Alien, the big, like
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
those don't scare me. Stuff like that doesn't scare me. The ones with the, you know, the stereotypical, you know, Area 51 aliens
with the like in the Signs.
The aliens in Signs scared me really bad.
Oh, that's interesting, because I was actually about to use Signs as an example of I was much more frightened of them when I could not see them. And then as soon as they showed me what they looked like, I was like, oh, fuck this. This is stupid. I don't care anymore. I'm not scared now.
By the time I saw them, I think I was so far into being fucking terrified
mm.
that even just a glimpse. And they, until later in the movie, you still only see like a quick glimpse. And that was really frightening. Once it's in the house and it's all big and whatever, I was more interested in watching Joaquin Phoenix beat the shit out of it.
Yeah, I find it to be kind of a universal thing for me that the longer you keep a monster hidden, the more scared I'm going to be. And
yeah,
almost
well, that's why
inevitably, once you show it to me, all of my fear completely evaporates. Almost
yeah.
always. It's not always the case, but...
Did you see A Quiet Place?
No.
Oh, you should. It's very good. It's that same situation when you can't see it or you only see quick flashes of it and you don't really know what you're seeing.
Mm-hmm.
It's really frightening. Once you see the full body, it's like, okay.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But yeah, that movie's really good. I highly recommend it. It's very
scary.
Yeah,
I think being able to invent what you want is really effective. You know, it's not even inventing because usually your mind doesn't come up with a cogent theory
right.
on what something looks like, and that's part of what makes it so frightening, is it could be any of these things.
Yeah, and something like in here with these angels, we're seeing them, we see that they do something, their
mm-hmm.
hands come down, like something happens because of them,
right?
But it's ratcheting up the tension as we go along.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I love, like, by now we have seen them a few different places, and we know that they should really not be here. So the fact that they are here at all is, like, the first thing that's really scary is, like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
They followed you into a fucking, like, underground police facility? Like, this feels real bad.
Yeah.
And then the additional, like, oh, and it's moving. And it's moving when you can't see it. And we heard the doctor say, don't blink, don't look away from it. They're very fast. So we have an idea that this is a real bad thing that's about to happen as he closes his eyes. And sure enough.
And then when she goes back, the police box is gone. Billy is gone.
Mm-hmm.
And the door has been broken.
Right. He is so pretty. I'm sorry, I got distracted. I just saw the part where he's yelling after her. Definitely get a phone, you gorgeous girl. Stop it, you charmer. I hate you.
And even when she's like, are you hitting on me? He's like, life is short and you are hot.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, you gotta take your shot, I guess.
You know? I think I also have like a kind of soft spot for him because the lone dude that I dated while I was in London, I don't even remember where he was from, but he had the same sort of energy where like I walked by him on the street and he was like, hey, can I have your number? And I was like, oh, I don't have a phone. Sorry. Like, cause I was really not doing well in London, guys. Spoiler alert. And he was very like bright and just,
dynamic.
Yeah. You know, charismatic, but in that way that, if it were somebody else saying these exact words, it would be creepy.
Mm-hmm.
But for whatever reason, maybe just that he was very attractive because he was, it's not. And he kept calling me fruity, which is fruity. Just so funny to me. Yeah. It's a really kind of like antiquated sort of compliment.
I've never heard that.
Yeah. It's meant to convey that you are very like curvy and luscious.
Oh my.
Yeah. So he would constantly call me fruity, and I just, like, found that so hilarious.
You're like a peach.
Yeah, like, pretty much was what he was sort of saying. He was, like, on the street and on the phone with somebody, and then, like, got off the phone with them and stopped me. And it turned out that he had been driving past me and pulled over and pretended to talk to his friend to give him an excuse to be standing there so that he could talk to me and get my number. And he had to give me his because I didn't have a number and he didn't expect me to call. And when I did, he was like, oh, shit, I just didn't expect to hear from you. What's up? But yeah, he was a very fit black man with a vague Caribbean accent that I could not place. And it was a good time. It was a good time while it lasted.
I think there's a fine line between this kind of thing being creepy and gross.
Mm-hmm.
And because we as women deal with this kind of stuff all the time, I think we can tell the difference between somebody who's just being disgusting and somebody who's like, no, I actually, like, I had to pull over my car
because
you were so fine.
And like, I was being really
genuinely like, I couldn't pass up the opportunity.
Yep. Yeah, those were the days when I could make people stop their car and get out. I had a guy go in reverse for half a block. He literally was he was driving past me. I saw him look at me out his window, and he kept driving for like half a block, and then he seemed to be like, you know what? Fuck it. And he stopped his car and went in reverse and just stopped in the middle of the street and was like, hey, what's up? And I was like, absolutely nothing is up. Move on. Because he was not attractive at all and definitely had a way creepier vibe. But I miss having that kind of superpower, Jamie. I really do.
I do, too. I had it once as well. And I did not appreciate it at the time.
Honestly, you know, this is part of the reason why I'm so pro sex work. Because if you find a way to profit off of something that is that powerful, but also that fleeting, fucking do it, baby. You know, like, just honestly, I wish that I had, while I had the materials available to me, that I had built a little bit of a business off it and made some money. I really wish I had done something, whether it's stripping or just selling foot pictures. I don't know. But I wish I had done something. I did consider
becoming a stripper
when
I was like 20.
I wish I had, because I considered it and then I was like, because I knew everybody was going to give me a hard time about it. Not because I didn't want to do it. And I wish I hadn't let that stop me.
I had a friend of a friend who was a stripper, and we were talking at a party, and she was telling me how much money she made. And I was just like, holy shit.
Right?
Because I was 20. She was making like $1,500 a week.
Mm-hmm.
And which is still more than I make now. And she was like, you should do it. You would make a lot of money. And I considered it. I went so far as to actually set up an audition.
Did you go?
And then I chickened out.
Ah, Jamie.
Because I was like, I don't think I would like doing this.
Mm.
I was very insecure, and it felt like a desperate move that would make me dislike myself.
Mm.
Instead of, like, even though I have no problem with stripping, like, for other people,
mm-hmm.
I think it's great. Do it. Get people's money, please. They're that dumb. Let them throw their money at you. But for me, I already had issues.
Mm.
And I felt like it was going to make those issues worse. Because I wouldn't be able to separate what I believe for other people for myself.
Yeah. Yeah. I just was like, I just really didn't want to hear the lecture was really all it came down to. And so I was just like, ugh. There's other stuff I could do, I guess.
Yeah, but, that there was that too. Like, I would never have been able to tell my family what I was doing.
Yeah. But, yeah, anybody out there who's considering getting into sex work, you know, be safe about it, be careful, and take care of yourself and all that. But then fucking do it and make that money. Make it.
I have gone to many a strip club and had many conversations with the dancers because I love them.
I have never been to a strip club ever.
Really?
Not
They're
once.
Very fun. If you go to good ones, when you go to the ones that are kind of yuck, you just feel bad for the girls.
Yeah.
But when you go to ones where, like, the girls are making a lot of money and they're clearly having a good time,
mm-hmm.
it's really fun. Really, really fun.
And
the girls like when there are girls there. The dancers really like it.
Yeah, I could see that for sure. I'm sure it adds a feeling, if only an illusion. Of the, it being a little bit safer, too, sometimes. Even though, like, you know, they're protected, usually, as far as I know. But
I think they mostly are, yeah.
Yeah. But anyway, so, again, side tangent. He gets pulled somewhere else, and then the doctor shows up and tries to explain to him what happened, but doesn't do any sort of good job about the explanation, because he doesn't like to, like, explain to people the basics of the fact that he is like a alien being with knowledge and abilities that they would never understand. So he just jumps right into like that hardcore explanation, and really they need some basics, and he just isn't interested in doing that.
Well, he like explains everything, but it's really fast, and it's in all of his like doctor speak
mm-hmm.
of like talking about things like, oh, this is a modified lunchbox, and it detects when people come from a different time, blah, blah, blah. He's, like, talking really fast, and here's this guy who's like, wait, what the fuck
right.
just happened?
Yeah. Yep. He, first, welcome. This dude says, where am I? 1969. Not bad as it goes. You've got the moon landing to look forward to. Like, no. I want to get a spray bottle and spray the doctor and be like, no, this is not
Martha
how you introduce somebody to this idea.
Martha's not helping either. She's like, we've gone three times.
I know, right?
Like,
Martha, hello, girl.
Come on.
You should know better than anybody how disorienting this is.
Yeah.
And
then he tells tells Billy that he has to get a message to Sally Sparrow, but it's going to take a while.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is going to take a while. It's a real understatement. Touch of an angel, same one probably, since you ended up in the same year. No, no, don't get up. Time travel without a capsule. Nasty. Like, dude, catch your breath. Don't go swimming for half an hour. And he's just like, what in the fuck is going on? And I'm like,
yeah.
Honestly, that's the question.
Although that is a good explanation of why Billy ended up in the same place as the doctor and Martha. Maybe different angels send you to different places.
And here's the thing you were talking about. The only psychopaths in the universe to kill you nicely. No mess, no fuss. They just zap you into the past and let you live to death. The rest of your life used up and blown away in the blink of an eye. You die in the past, and in the present, they consume the energy of all the days that you had ahead of you. All your stolen moments. So, yeah, I guess it's supposed to be that because they're put into the past, that energy isn't extant anymore. But I don't.
Maybe it just becomes a different type of energy.
Yeah.
Like they're stealing away what his future was supposed to be.
Right.
But giving them a future, a different future where their potential maybe cannot be realized in the same way.
Okay. I see what you're saying.
Because Billy goes back, does not stay a cop. Which I can understand because probably in 1969, 1970, being a black man in England, like everywhere, probably wasn't very easy to be a cop. To become a cop.
Yeah, that's true.
So he got into a different business.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he got into publishing, and that's how they get the Easter eggs up in there. Smarty
now,
pants.
I have to say, this moment where Sally gets a phone call, and it's minutes later since Billy was disappeared, and she goes to this nursing home where there's this old man, Billy, who's dying, fucking broke my heart.
Aw.
Like, made me cry yesterday rewatching. Has made me cry every time. It's so sad and so beautifully performed by these two actors who now it's a completely different actor playing old Billy, but has the same sort of chemistry with her that, you know, they've only met once for a few minutes and but had this little connection, and she's really heartbroken that she lost out on years, what could have been.
Yep.
And that now he's dying. And when he says that he only has until the rain stops, I was just like, fuck this show.
Right.
That is brutal.
And he married somebody named Sally.
Yeah.
The whole thing.
And he seems all right. Like, I lived a life. And it was fine.
Mm-hmm.
And I got into this. I did this publishing and eventually got into DVDs. So he's the one who put the Easter egg on all these DVDs, and he tells her to look at the list.
Right. I love that the first thing he wakes up and says, it was raining when we met. And, like, all he knows is that the next time they meet is also going to be the day that he dies.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure if he is aware at the start of this day that he's going to see her by the end of it.
I don't think so.
But that is, like, messed up for this woman to show up and you're simultaneously like, oh, yeah, I get to see her again. And also, I guess I'm dying later.
Yeah. And like, when he says it was raining when we met, and she says it's the same rain.
Yeah.
Oh. Ugh.
Ah! And he tries to reach, like, he thinks about reaching out to her before this. But he says apparently that would have ripped a hole in time and destroyed 2/3 of the universe. So... Yeah. Couldn't do it. And also, I'd lost my hair.
Still a charmer.
Yep. So, yeah, that's that information, that little goodbye. We don't actually see him die.
Yeah.
We just see the fast forward to her in the room alone later.
Mm-hmm. And the rain has stopped.
Yeah. And the rain is so wild because it's like raining while it's still sunny outside.
Mm-hmm.
The way that this is done. Have you ever had that kind of rain?
Yeah, I lived in Florida.
It is the most disorienting shit. That was not something that I ran into almost ever in Connecticut. But down here in Texas, it's definitely more of a thing. And it's just so weird. It makes everything feel fake.
Mm-hmm.
You know, these are not supposed to go together. And you can actually see sometimes before it started raining, you can see the line of the rain moving toward you because everything is so flat. And that's also a thing that I never ran into in Connecticut.
That happened here last week. I was driving home from work, and ahead of me, I can see downtown from the area of the city that I live in.
Mm-hmm.
So I could see downtown, and there's this building that we call the Pencil, which is in Midtown. It looks like a giant pencil. And it was completely obscured. And I was like, wow, it is pouring at the Pencil, which is only a mile and a half from my house. And like seconds later, it started raining where I was driving. But I could see this, like, what looked like a storm mm-hmm. a mile away because it was clear where I was for a few minutes.
So weird, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Owen and I were, when we were on vacation a few weeks or months ago now, we were at this lake chilling, and it definitely looked like it was going to storm, but it wasn't yet. And we were sitting there at the edge, and there are all these trees around, and we started to hear this, like, spattering getting slowly louder and louder, and it was the storm coming at us. And we tried to beat it out of there, but we didn't quite make it. But you could hear it getting louder as it came across the trees towards us, and it was a really wild moment. Life is long and you are hot is one of the last things that he says to her. And I was just like, oh man, this sucks. So she calls up, Larry and tells him that the messages, the Easter eggs were meant for her. And every single one of the DVDs that she wound up with has one on it.
Well, it's the list of the DVDs, what they didn't seemingly have anything in common.
Mm-hmm.
But she realizes what they have in common are they are all DVDs that she owns.
So his response is like, not just the specific
ones she owns, but like it's on all of the copies of those 17 movies.
Right. But I love the fact that all he hears is not like, these were a message meant for me, which is the wild thing. He just hears you only have 18 DVDs. And I was just like, dude, stop it. Get out of here. So she's talking to this recording. And it feels like the doctor's replying to her. But when she is in the middle of like being like, oh my God, he can hear me. Larry's like, no, he can't hear you. He says it like this every single time. It's written down, like there's a transcript of it. And yet, the conversation that she's having still seems to be happening naturally.
Yep.
And he sits down and is like, you know what? I'm going to write your side down. And what she winds up, like the doctor explains, is the reason that he can have what seems like a normal conversation with her is because Larry was here transcribing the whole thing. And mm-hmm. so he wound up getting a transcript of their conversation and is able to explain to her what he explains.
Yeah.
Which is a pretty fun little loophole that I like for them to be able to talk.
It's like a paradox, and generally paradoxes shouldn't happen.
Mm-hmm.
But all of this is happening because of little paradoxes.
Yeah.
And I like when she's having this conversation with the video. She like takes a look at what Larry is doing, realizes what's going on, and then like stops what she's doing and goes, wait, you know shorthand?
Yeah. I enjoyed that also because I low-key was thinking when he was like, oh, I'm going to write your part down. I was like, go ahead, I guess. It's not as easy as they're making it seem like, but I guess I won't worry about that for right now. So, he explains exactly how these angels work, that they turn into a statue when something is looking at them.
Mm-hmm.
So there are moments when they can move when you have your back turned or when you even blink. And it is a really like freaky idea that I really like.
And they can't look at each other because even looking at each other would turn them to stone.
Right. Oh, and also this video is where he says that the timey-wimey,
wibbly-wobbly stuff.
Which is one of the few things that I have heard from Doctor Who.
I would have been surprised if you hadn't heard it, but there have been a number of times that I've wanted to say it and couldn't because we hadn't gotten to this episode yet.
Yeah, it was not something like I just, you know, heard it out of context
mm-hmm.
and figured that because the vibe of the quote felt goofy and whimsical. Mm-hmm. And so I was just like, oh yeah, that's got to be Doctor Who. But I don't think I ever got that confirmed or anything. I just was like, that makes sense.
Yeah. I still refer to things sometimes as, no, it's just timey-wimey. It just became part of my vernacular. And I think it had the same effect on most Doctor Who viewers, which is why it's something you've heard.
Right, yeah.
It's just one of those things that just became, like the Weeping Angels themselves, a very iconic Doctor Who thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, what is it that he says that Larry says he's going to get on a t-shirt?
What did he say?
Because he says something about, like, the angels stole my police box.
Oh, the angels have the police box.
That's right.
The angels have the police box. And that is, you can get that on t-shirts.
Yeah, I would think that saying I'm going to get that on a t-shirt would just make that basically appear in online t-shirt stores across the world.
Yeah. I'm not sure if there's an official Doctor Who merch that says it. I'm sure there is, but there are definitely, like, fan-made shirts that say, and stickers and everything that say, the angels have the police box.
Right. And I should say, too, that they're, like, watching this video on his laptop while they're in the house where everybody disappeared from, which feels like a real bad idea to me. You don't go... the whole point of this is that you're trying to get information about these things and about what's been happening. You don't go to the location of this all going down without being armed with the information first. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Don't like this. But yeah, she asks how he has the transcript and he just says, I'm a time traveler. I got it in the future. Which I was just like, you know, how fucking, well, duh, he is about it. They have taken the blue box, haven't they? The angels have the phone box. The angels have the phone box. That's my favorite. I've got that on a t-shirt. creatures from another world. But they're just statues, only when you see them. The Lonely Assassins, they used to be called. No one quite knows where they came from, but they're as old as the universe or very nearly. They have the most perfect defense system ever evolved. They are quantum locked. They don't exist when they are being observed. The moment they are seen by any other living creature, they freeze into rock. It's a fact of their biology. In the sight of any living thing, they literally turn to stone. And you can't kill a stone. Of course, a stone can't kill you either, but then you turn your head away. I'm like, well, a stone can kill you. I mean, something threw a stone at her and you told her to duck. So that's sort of flatly untrue. But also, even if they are, you can't kill a stone, could you just bust up a statue and put its parts in different places?
Not sure.
I mean, you could
if it's an actual statue, but I'm not sure about these.
If you're staring at it, then it stays a statue, right?
Yeah, but maybe they can't be blown up.
I didn't say blown up. I just said that you could break them into pieces.
Maybe the kind of stone that they turn into is unbreakable. I don't know. They don't address this. You would think it'd be a pretty obvious question.
Regardless, he says, but then you blink, and oh, yes, it can. Don't take your eyes off that. That's why they cover their eyes. They're not weeping. They can't risk looking at each other. Their greatest asset is their greatest curse. They can never be seen. Loneliest creatures in the universe. So, that's pretty wild. I enjoy that. And, he tells her, you need to go and get that blue box back and you need to send it to me. And she asks how, and he just is like, that's it. There's no more from you on this transcript. So gotta go. And I was just like, oh, that's not a good sign. And indeed it is not, because this thing is right the fuck here. Don't blink. Don't even blink. Blink. And you're dead. They are fast. Faster than you can believe. Don't turn your back. Don't look away. And don't blink. Girl, is it just me? Or is the instant somebody telling you not to blink, you feel like you can't do anything unless you blink immediately?
Yeah. It's like seeing someone yawn.
Yeah, it's a very good comparison. I just, like, can't. And the first time that they, like, look up, once they, like, realize that neither of them is looking at these statues, this thing is right there with its fucking mouth open and its pointy teeth, and it's terrifying.
Yep.
It is terrifying.
I love it. And Sally's like, okay, you keep looking at it. I'm going to look for a way out.
Girl, no.
And he's just like, and gets to the point, like any human being would. It's like, I can't keep my eyes open anymore.
You know what you got to do? You got to blink on separate sides. You got to wink instead of blink. And then just have one eye getting its moisture and the other eye is still open and watching. And then you get close the other eye and you just really carefully, consciously alternate.
That would probably work.
It'd probably work. So, yeah, he's yelling at her, like, why are they after you? And she says that she has the key to the blue box. And he's basically like, okay, give it to them then. And she's like, did you not watch the video that I just watched? Because he very explicitly said not to do that, that would be bad. And they get basically chased out of this house down into the basement where there are a group of them that are somehow turning the lights out.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I want to know how this works also. Because it's pointing.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all it's doing. But it's managing to turn the lights out. Not really, though. Because the lights just flicker a lot. They come back just enough for us to see that the angels are getting closer. How do they do it?
I don't know. These notes I have say that it's draining the light.
Draining the light. Huh. Okay.
So that's what's making it flicker, but not completely stay out.
Hmm. All right. Well, it's a pretty good sequence because, as they, you know, come at them and the lights go on and off again, they just like keep making their way forward and it's really freaky.
Mm-hmm.
And, eventually they get into the TARDIS and they put like, there's the doctor's hologram pops up and is like, you have a disc authorized for one journey. Please insert disc and prepare for departure. And they do that, but then these angels are still coming at them, and the TARDIS is like going transparent and insubstantial.
Yeah.
And I definitely was like, what the fuck did he just do? Why is he leaving them there? Like, I got very upset and anxious about it. But it turns out that whatever is, like, built into the disc that they had, like, tells the TARDIS to just leave and not bring them with it. And all of the angels have their arms out and are gathered around the TARDIS. And they don't have their eyes protected. So once it actually disappears, they are staring at each other and they can never move again because they are always being observed by one another, which is messed up. And yeah,
pretty smart.
I wonder, because there's, you know, we were talking earlier about the same angel can send you to the same time. And I wonder if she and Larry would have wound up in the same time or if they would have each gotten gripped up by different angels and got sent to separate places alone. Because at least being with somebody, you know, you have that moral support. But being separated, that would really suck. That's the part that's just like, there's literally not a soul I can tell what happened to me because nobody's going to believe this.
Yeah, I don't know if one angel can disappear two people at once.
Hmm. Yeah. That's interesting. So they get out of there. And then we fast forward 1 year later. And she is evidently working at the shop that Larry was working at.
I think it's their own because it's called Sparrow and Nightingale or something.
Is it?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I didn't even notice that. So he comes across her, like, you know, putting together information about the angels and the photos and everything. And he is frustrated with the fact that she doesn't want to let this go. And I have to say, not mad at her. She was in the weirdest experience, and so were you. And the fact that you find it easy to just move on from this is baffling to me, frankly. Like, you guys got chased down by time-traveling killer angel statues and a time-traveling alien man communicated with you through a DVD Easter egg on multiple DVDs, and a man that she had chemistry with died 60 years older in front of her, however much older. Yeah, she gets to be obsessed with this.
Also,
that's fine.
His sister disappeared and lived out her life at the beginning of the 20th century.
Yeah, you know what? I keep forgetting because that just doesn't seem to have affected him, that that was his sister. But yeah, you're right. He seems weirdly, not really cut up about that.
Like I said earlier, he's not a very bright bulb.
Yeah, it's true.
He's a very simple man.
Because, yeah, when she first says, like, she wanted me to tell you that she loves you. And he's like, is she ill? Am I ill? And she's like, no, it's nothing like that. But then she is going to have to explain to him, but she is gone forever.
Right.
And we don't actually see that happen, do we? Her
no.
telling him what happened to his sister?
No.
Yeah, it's a weird thing to just kind of go through this all with him and not have told him throughout.
Let me go meet my nephew who's older than me.
Right, you know? And he tries to tell her, look, some things you never find out, and that's okay. And I'm just like, dude, you can't. That's something like you say to somebody who lost their car keys a month ago, and they're still obsessing over where their car keys could have gone because they remember putting them down in this place. That's not something you say about time traveling attack, stone statues and aliens and fucking TARDIS that vanished from around you. And like, no, sir. You're the one that's being irrational, frankly. And he says something like, don't you think that this is getting in the way of other things? Obviously trying to be like, you know, if you weren't so obsessed with this, you could have all of this. And I'm like, that's really not as tempting as you seem to think it is, sir. We had Billy in the same episode.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, but no. And like in the end, they do have the two of them holding hands like it's supposed to signal that this is her moving on. And I'm like, girl, you could do a lot better than this guy. It doesn't have to be him. It's fine. You could go meet somebody else. But, you know, they needed to symbolize her deciding to finally abandon this whole thing.
Yeah. Oh, sorry.
How dare
my microphone. So he goes to get milk or something and she looks out the window and sees the doctor and Martha getting out of a taxi.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it, like, you know, clearly she's thinking that they're here to talk to her. And it turns out that they are not here for anything related to her at all. There's a whole other thing going on. They're
Four
talking about the
a lizard.
Hatching.
Mm-hmm.
And they both have bows and arrows.
Mm-hmm.
And she realizes that that was how he got the transcript, was from her. And that for him, this hasn't happened yet because he does not recognize her. And she gives him all of that while Martha continually yells at him, time is running out. And I was like, Martha, give him a second. Christ, can't you hear this girl say, oh, that's right. I'm the one who gave you the information. It's important. Just give him a second.
Yeah.
And then she does. And then she's like, all right, well, bye. And holds Larry's hand. Make sure you've got this with you when you go to 1969. You're gonna need it. And it's a lovely little purple sleeve that I really thought was nice and noticeable. Good choice. Something that's not going to get mixed up with all of your other files when you find yourself having to grab things before getting stuck in 1969. Yeah, it's a good moment. And the doctor like gives her a sort of a look when he says, "Oh, nice to meet you, Sally Sparrow." And I was like, is he flirting with her? Because it felt for a second like he was flirting with her. And then
he might have been.
When Larry walks up, the doctor sort of clams up a little bit, I felt like. And I was like, that was interesting. I feel like you were having a little bit of a moment there.
She's very pretty.
I'm still mad, though, that the doctor never hooked up with that tree woman from the first episode. Because I feel like that would have been pretty fascinating. And then we get the closing montage of all of the different statues all over London that are constantly around and watching. And the doctor telling you, don't blink, blink, and you're dead. And I was like, well, thank God I live in fucking the suburbs of America where there is nothing like this ever. And I will not have to worry at all.
Did you see that picture I posted on Instagram of back in like, it's like in November or something? I was at a museum and there was this statue of Medea and it was very beautiful. But part of me was like, well, now I can never look away because she's going to come at me with that knife that she's holding.
Listen, Medea, I mean, she had a bad time. She gets to murder a little bit.
Gorgeous statue. Seriously.
But no, I did not see that post, though.
Yeah, I didn't reference Doctor Who in it because we had not gotten here yet. I didn't want to spoil you somehow.
Whee!
This episode is based on a short story that Stephen Moffat wrote for the Doctor Who annual in 2006 called What I Did on My Christmas Holidays by Sally Sparrow. It involves Sally Sparrow, who is a child in the story, writing her school assignment about being contacted by the Ninth Doctor through photographs and a videotape.
Ooh, that's cool.
In which he gives her instructions to allow her to return the TARDIS to him. The Weeping Angels are not present in this story, but the Doctor being separated from the TARDIS is a point of it.
Okay.
So I guess he had this sort of like idea or whatever rolling around in his mind. Now, I'm not a huge fan of Stephen Moffat other than what he did in several of these episodes, which I find to be really beautiful storytelling.
Mm-hmm.
He said that he had intended to write a two-parter earlier in the series, like the season, but was too busy writing and executive producing Jekyll. Believing that he had messed everything up, Moffat offered to throw himself onto the grenade of the unpopular episode, referring to the Dr. Light concept. In a 2008 interview, he admitted that he had only just started realizing that Blink was, in fact, a really great episode. Because of its late submission, Blink was the quickest piece of writing Moffat had ever done, having gone straight from the second draft with no notes to the script and tone meetings before going into production 10 days later. The scriptwriting process took such little time to produce that Moffat claimed that Blink was such a tiniest sliver of his writing career that he couldn't remember making it. He's such an ass.
Honestly, you don't end it up with saying, being like, oh yeah, this is like really popular and people absolutely love it, but it meant nothing to me.
He's Come such on, dude. An ass. I cannot stand him. Other little pieces of trivia that aren't rage-inducing.
Is he trying to be like cute about how it's called Blink? And like, oh yeah, it was barely a blink for me. Like, is that what he's trying to do?
I don't know. I don't understand him. He's such an arrogant piece of shit.
Guys, Jamie's real mad. Oh, God.
So the DVD store that Larry worked in previously, there's a whole bunch of like posters and DVD covers that you see. Every single one of those was a made-up title.
Oh, cool. Okay.
Yeah. So they made all these fake titles and DVD covers and posters and all this stuff, which I think is fun.
That is fun. Yeah, Acid Burn. I like that
one. Is that
one
of them?
Yeah, that was one that like she really focuses on for a second.
That's not one of the ones that they mention here. They say Breakfast in the Rain, Dance of Days, Civilization Zero, Angel Smile, Falling Star, One Oak Country, My Best Friend's Boyfriend, Mean Teens, and Shooting the Sun.
So they're all, like, low-key based on existing Doctor Who episodes then, right?
I don't think so.
Shooting the Sun.
And Mean Teens. I like that.
I'm trying to think, what was the other one that you said? Dance of Days?
Dance of Days, yeah.
What one could that be? I mean, that just sounds like time traveling. So it could be like any number of things.
Breakfast in the Rain sounds like some like Merchant Ivory movie.
Oh, God. And that'd be fun, though. I wonder if anybody's like, you know, checked up on tying some of those titles together, like if they're meant to be significant or anything like that.
I don't know. Maybe. This also was the first episode to be directed by a woman after a 22-year interval.
Good God.
Yeah.
Good God. Guys, what are we doing? What are we doing as a species that we're just like, yeah. Oh, yeah, no, 50% of the population, we just kind of count out. I guess we could have one of... I
suppose we could let someone with a vagina handle directing other people around.
I guess.
And yet you get this like really beautifully shot episode.
Mm-hmm. It is, and too.
And you look at like Breaking Bad. Michelle McLaren directed a number of episodes on Breaking Bad, and they are all so fucking gorgeous. And almost, I mean, that show's beautiful anyway, but anytime it was a Michelle McLaren episode, I could tell because she did really creative things with the camera. She was really great with using space and showing like the skyline and, you know, whatever in New Mexico. Like, she's amazing, and nobody's been like, we need to give her some movie deals because she's a woman.
Yep.
It's insane.
Guys, y'all can say that's not why all you want, but yeah, you know it is. You know it is. Stop it.
A little bit of trivia that has nothing to do with Doctor Who, but has to do with Carey Mulligan. She is married to the lead singer of... God damn it. I can see him and I can hear their music, and it flew out of my head.
Sing the music. Sing the music that you can hear.
I will not. I wish that you did different kind of editing so you could edit out my fuck up.
I mean, I could edit this out. Everybody's
screaming right now.
But I'm not gonna. Because I like for everybody to be, like, really... I want it to be an immersive experience.
Mumford and Sons! God, it just had to come to me. She's married to lead singer of Mumford and Sons. It was not your fault,
but mine. Is that them? Yeah. All right, cool. That's interesting. I want to ask, but I know that you can't answer me, so I'm not going to ask. But I really want to know if these angels turn up again. I hope they do. But I know you can't tell me, so don't say anything. We have new patrons. We have two. Well, one, I think, is an older patron, but I'm going to mention them anyway. Diego Zenhausen and Lena B. both became patrons over this past week. So thank you both very, very much for pledging. Hope that you guys are enjoying the shows. Right now doing the Harry Potter reread and the Twilight first read. And that has finally reached the point where Miles is starting to get angry. He has been a very good sport and has, but there is no way that you could read these and not start to get irritated after a point. And we have reached that spot. And I think you all know what I'm talking about. And I'm excited about it because he has been so much more patient than I have throughout this. And so much more like willing to give Bella the benefit of the doubt than I have. And now he's starting to be like, what the fuck? And I'm like, exactly.
I don't know which part of... You're still doing New Moon, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't know what part you're talking about because it's been a really long time since I read that. But I found her frustrating from the beginning, so...
Same. He was really... He wanted to do this in good faith. So, like I said, he's been giving her the benefit of the doubt a lot. Mm-hmm. And just more than I can, apparently.
When did the Volturi come into this? Is that that book?
Yes. Volturi. Is that...
Volturi, whatever.
Yeah, VOLTURI. But we have not met them yet. Don't say anything about it.
Okay. the only reason I've ever considered watching those movies, because I just wanted to see Michael Sheen.
Yes. But don't say anything about it. I don't know if he listens to this. I don't think he does, but I also don't want that spoiled for him.
Okay.
But yeah, I really think that if you guys are into coverage of like pop culture work like that, that you would be digging this Twilight show. It's pretty fun. And I'm just enjoying Miles being so open to a thing, you know, because he just had such a reputation for just being a cranky old git.
Well, he was for a while.
He was. And he's just really starting to, like, he got sick of himself is kind of what happened. And it's just amazing. So, also.
Well, it takes so much energy to hate stuff. It takes very little energy to love it. Or to at least be open to it.
That is so untrue. I wish I agreed with you, because then life would be a lot easier for me. But I do not agree with you.
I guess to actively hate. To go, you know, to feel that kind of anger over something that you don't have to.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think that's part of it also is the don't have to, because there are things that I like cover because it's part of my job now, and then I get so angry because I feel like I started off loving this thing and you're ruining it and you're ruining my job for me, and why would you do this to me?
I'm afraid to ask.
Well, Game of Thrones mostly.
But, oh, okay.
You know. So that was the one thing I wanted to say on new patrons. And then I saw that we, did we get a new review?
If we did, it came in today. So let me just take a quick look.
Oh, no, I don't think so. Georgia Peach. There was one that you read that isn't showing up for me. But whatever the case, the one that I'm looking at is from like May 31st. So.
Yeah, no, there's one after that. That was from like 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, it's so weird. I don't know why a comment cast doesn't always like get everything, because it's supposed to. That's the whole
point. God, that stopped working for me a long time ago.
Yeah, it stopped working, and then I redid the key, and then it worked again. I don't know if it's working now because it maybe looks like it's not. Who knows? It's all a real fun game. Let's play. Is there anything else you want to mention before we wrap this up?
I don't think so. I hope that our listeners are pleased with how we discussed this episode, because they were really, really excited.
Right on.
That we were up to blink.
Up to blink.
They were very hopeful that you were going to enjoy it. And I just wanted to be like, I mean, how could you not?
What if I hated it?
I feel like that's impossible. It's a really good episode.
Yeah.
It's just a really good episode of television, not just a really good episode of Doctor Who. So I wasn't worried about you not liking this one.
I just can't, like, I'm trying to think if there was ever a show episode of something that I was really excited for somebody to get to and then they hated it. And I don't think, you know what? There was once, but I won't put them on blast, but they had very valid problems, but it was a problem with a trope that I wasn't familiar with at the time. So their frustration just felt alien to me. And now that I am more familiar, I get it. But at the time I was just kind of like, what are you talking about? Stop. It's great. But yeah, so. All right, guys. Well, thank you all so much for listening. Hope you've enjoyed the show. Hope you've enjoyed this one in particular. And
leave us a review if you haven't yet.
Yeah, make sure to do that, because we're going to read them. And we will see you again soon with a new episode. Toodaloo, motherfuckers.
Bye. Don't blink.
Was an Unspoiled Network podcast.